Today we will be discussing the seventh season of Literary Prize of Alexander Piatigorsky, named after Alexander Piatigorsky. It is a long path. It's 7 years from the beginning, and the way we were making this path, every time it was very interesting, and every year we are coming out with five nominees of the short list. And this year's summer, we also chose the next five nominees. Also, we had changes on the board of the juries. We were joined by more philosophers. And nevertheless, this year, for the first time, the prize among the nominees were the novel writer. The Alexander Piatigorsky Prize, it's by its very characteristics, unites the representatives of different genres, because Alexander Moiseevich Piatigorsky hosted so many people of different professions: philologists, theatrical directors, cinema, philosophers, whoever was interested in the philosophical and thinking matter, in the consciousness itself, and the method of implementation of this thought would be not important. And in this sense, Alexander Piatigorsky was terribly necessary for those people. And this conversation should go on. And also, Alexander Piatigorsky was an author himself, not only of the works on Oriental studies, Buddhologist, but he's also the author of the novels, whose main questions was how, after the experiences of the 20th century, the experience of violence and fear, we can remain historical beings, free historical beings, to be part of the world process. And our participation in the Frankfurt International Book Fair is part of our the prize's general intention to speak of how Russian language can remain within the problems of that are posed before the whole of the world. And the seventh season is characterized by the fact that and it's the first time that we are speaking before the international audiences. And because the task of the literary prize is twofold. First, it's the popularization of this kind of effort within Russian culture, and also the narration about it, perhaps realized in the framework of our literary prize, to speak about this cultural conscientious efforts of Russian culture, it's staying within the world history, to be able to speak about it on the international stage. And this today we are glad to discuss these five books. The laureate has not been yet selected, but also we have a tradition of having five conversations with our nominees, and that are presented also in the presentation of this literary site. And now I want to represent my partner in the conversation, Zinaida Starodubtseva, art critic. She also participated in the discussion in one of the discussions with Alexander Ilichevsky, one of the nominees, the novel writer. The first season we had novels, all novels, but in the next seasons we had always scientific monographies or some just way of non-fiction thinking, but never novels. So Zinaida was conducting the meeting with Alexander Ilichevsky, the novel writer, but also you can look through this conversation and the four other conversations with our authors in our presentation. But today we will talk about the impressions, but also of these five authors. But also we will be speaking about the impressions of the overall of the season overall, and we will be speaking about this bigger picture of the seventh season. I think that the season continues the previous ones. Even if we look at the names like Mikhail Yampolsky, Mikhail Zorin, who was actually who read a lecture course to us, the Eastern politics of Catherine the Great. I think that the Piatigorsky Prize in itself, just as the figure of Piatigorsky himself, I think it's like a big projection lamp, casts the light over the circle of names that is connected to the Soviet 70s, when the literary artistic circles were connecting people of different professions and who were actually aiming at the interdisciplinary approach. Part of those people left when Perestroika happened, or perhaps a bit earlier, when they emigrated a bit earlier, and many of them occupied academic positions in the international universities, but they continue the activities connected to Russian culture, and also they are those kind of people that for the Western audience, for the students there, for the reading public, create that cultural project that represents Russia. And I think that in this case it's important that each season that we had such names as Vladimir Malyavin, sinologist, as Alexander Rapoport, an architect, Mikhail Epstein. I think it's important, this tradition is important, that every year it reproduces itself and it makes this prize unique. And Olga Sedakova, of course, who lives here, but she's very connected with the European Italian culture. I think that we have a very big dispersal of names, and of course, it's not that for nothing that we are talking about the Russian language, because Russian language is not blocked within the national borderline. Once they made a map of Russian poets who are writing Russian language. Poets who are writing all over the world, and of course, and the same thing can be done for the thinking and writing. And of course, in the 70s, the late 70s gave a lot of time, free time to people, and it gave them an ability to create an alternative life that where a person being was not, when a person was not locked within his own professional outline, he was pushed to look for some switches to learn more. And therefore, for example, semiotics developed a lot because it's a science that works with signs, and it worked with signs in engineering or in the physics as well as the or psychology as well as the art science, for example. And perhaps it's one of the know-hows of Russian culture. It's like this passionate, furious interdisciplinary approach, not confined within the frames of one specialization, and to make it a quality project, you always need more time. And this tradition continues its life, and the style of thinking continues. When you are thinking the flows of information and energies, and you can go in between the borders, and you can find kind of porosity within the structure of reality, and you can be speaking about that and navigate through them to be able to see the future. And I think that all those authors we're talking about, they are working within the, they are very qualified within their framework of their professions, just as well as outside of them. There are many works, there are many interesting works in the long list as well, interesting poetic works. You have to say that Russian gender problematics was represented. There were two poetic books by Oksana Vasyakina and Maria Golovanivska. It's a very female problematics, not just in terms of emotions, but about in the conscientious positions they took. It's not them trying to be within the Vogue, but it's not that they're taking some cliches from American or any international external problematics, but they actually found that problematics within themselves. This is a very experienced, lived through problematics and well thought through. The rubrics of life, of life itself, that are showing within the Russian reality as such, what is happening to you because you're a woman, as a parameter of your life. And I think that was a joy to see that it is actually very organic. That a long-term sort of external or a little bit imposed problematics now seems to be a specific transgressed into the inner problematics. Another characteristics of this year was it was an interesting translator's efforts. If we could come back to the second season, it was exactly the translator that got the prize, the Piatigorsky Prize for her very important cultural efforts. We know very well that Russian language, in contradistinction with many other languages. It is enriched by its translation, because Russian language is experimenting within translation and adopts and appropriates the fruits of experimentation within its own structure. We can enumerate several historically important translations. This year we had wonderful translations of the post-structural space by Anastasia Zakharievich, the seventh function of the language by Laurent Binet, and two translations from the Hungarian, the chess play on the island by István Orosz. It was a chess play between Lenin and Bogdanov and his opponent, where this chess match on the Capri Island was showing like in a drop of sea drop, which is showing the furiousness and violence of the 20th century and of revolution. And the second translation of the same, Vyacheslav Serida, this translation of Krasnoharkai, the setting in tango. It's an amazing postmodern avant-garde work of literary piece about the people who find themselves in isolation, just like we now during COVID, that who decide to leave. It's a wonderful story from the 70s. It's like the basic cultural efforts of the Hungarian language that is now being transposed into Russian language. It's interesting how Russian language will respond. And before we pass to the nominees of the shortlist, but I would also want to continue talking about the long list for a little while. I could have made a couple of actually shortlists this year, and I hope Zina will join me. Grigory Revzin's book, architect and art critic, he's an urbanist. It's dedication. It's actually dedicated to his work with the city spaces, how the city is made. It's mesmerizing, and it mesmerizes you in terms of imagination. It's well known that we don't build new cities much these years. We are building houses, or we are changing the face of the districts, but we never build new cities. And Revzin is actually looking into the social forces that are needed for creation for the cities and find the expressions within the architecture of the town. It's sort of the book about the forecasts for social forces that create, that is very important for the healthy functioning of the city as an organism. And actually he's showing what will happen to the city if you cut out one of the forces. For example, when it becomes more like a military camp, when, once you are taking the traders away from it, or what will happen if you are taking the sacred part of the city, or the preservation parts of the city, what will happen? So that the city, for it to function as an organism, I think he, in this follows an old Aristotelian tradition to see a city polis as a bios, as a way of, as a form of life. And I think that, but in the same time, at the same time, this book is filled with concrete historical details and his stories, narrations about buildings, the building of the city, and how, for example, the Soviet city garden cities were created, how by American architects, for example, how the interaction with the world architecture was happening, and then you start, and then you begin to realize that the story of your country never was never excluded from the world history, and that's what Revzin's books gives you on to understand, and that's what Piatigorsky Prize is about. I'm sorry that sad that it's not on the short list, but perhaps you have a book that you fell in love with. And I think this is a book of effort of art critic Evgenia Kikodze, who held a conference, and this conference was dedicated to Vladimir Slipyan, who actually emigrated through Poland to France in the end of the 50s. And he actually was a witness to the last splash of the actionist painting, and he joined it in France and Spain, but he's had a tragic fate, and he died in the streets of Paris as a clochard, but as a beggar, vagabond. But his activities influenced several representatives of French philosophy, especially involved in the problem of human being and an animal, and the fate of this artist cannot be inscribed within the histories of success that are being translated of the, by the latest versions. It demonstrates a fate of a human who was a mathematician, who was an artist, who became a poet and a translator, who founded a certain publishing house that was went bankrupt, a person who was choosing his own path, unique path. He didn't wait for anything. He left in the end of the 70s to become part of the European international artistic movement, and the fates of such unique artists that become sort of the lightning house lamps by the kind of the torches within the night. It's important when in Moscow and St. Petersburg, because we're having new schools of contemporary art that become sort of the conveyors for preparation of new artists that teach them how to become part of the industry of the success, not how to avoid it, to work with it, or to oppose it, but in fact they are actually preparing new conformists. And in this way, the fate of Slipyan is actually quite vivid. There are several books I want to talk about. It's the Avant-Garde on the Linguistic Turns by Vladimir Fashenko. It's an extremely interesting the way he works with the Russian, the heritage of Russian avant-garde. and shows through what we can analyze it and how it can, what impact it can have for our life today. A very very interesting work by Dmitry Uzlanov, The End of Religion. Shows a theme of secularization at an interesting angle. We're speaking about secularization as a way to the modern society, but the contemporary approach shows that if you, for example, take an American society, then it shows that it's a very extremely religious society, but it's an extremely modern society. It's the attempt to work not necessarily from the European-centered angle. When we are looking for the points from which normal and abnormality of certain social models is being questioned, and we can look at a different angle, and perhaps we can look at different societies and their experience on entering the modernity. It's an interesting experiment to shift the research from the European-centered points, and American society being a completely different model. And perhaps other societies also are more compliant to that model, more in conformity to that model nowadays. And we can also say that the globalization is actually taking place, it follows the American model rather than European. And there is a wonderful book, Jewel Box. It's called The Guidebook Through N by Alexander Skidan. It's a very strange novel, a philological novel, a palimpsest novel. There was a method to it. He was sitting before his bookshelf. He was taking the books out and taking the quotations and making them into a book. And you never know whether you are within the author's words or within the quotation. But it's a conversation about Nietzsche as a basic event in the European culture. Basic event in the European culture. I was just speaking about the American culture as the new platform for the world. It's not European type of sense making, but Alexander Skidan is showing the points from that keeps emanating the European type of formation of sense of meaning, and this is the event that penetrates through history and that can be in its human form signed by the name of Friedrich Nietzsche, and Europe keeps preserving these points as generating point of it. I was reading correspondence between Soviet and European art critics, and the Soviet one is writing, to understand about symbolism, you must read Kant, and the French art critic is saying, no, only Nietzsche, and Skidan is really showing that Nietzsche is the secret name of everything. That Nietzsche is not a human being, but as Nietzsche himself said, I lived through the history of Europe, and it's something that is not inner to America. It's a fragile point, but Skidan is also connecting how it is connected to Russia as well, as in a very important figure of Lou Anders Salome, Russian woman, that she sort of pushed Nietzsche within Nietzsche as Russia is pushing Europe within the border of Europe. It's an interesting story, and it's a secret tension between Russia and Russia and Europe as well that it creates interesting tension that creates Nietzsche, and which is so different from Latin America, from America, from all other cultures that creates Europe. A very interesting book, correspondence between Russian philosopher Vladimir Bibikin and the poet Olga Sidakova, correspondence between philosopher and a poet, very famous people here and within Russian tradition. And we talked with Kirill Martynov, my constant partner in conversation, through the long list. We are reading it for the members of jury, but also it's like a digest of impressions for the wider audience, for the readership. friendship. And this is a book, this book of correspondence, that that discusses the phenomenon of fame coming, the new Russian fame of the two people who just recently in the ex-Soviet space could never become public, and suddenly they become public, they go public, as she just, Ольга Александровна Седокова is writing that, for example, Бибихин's translations, philosophical translations, were creating the whole intellectual scene. He was translating from Grigoris Palama to Martin Heidegger and Jacques Derrida, and he was creating the whole landscape, intellectual landscape of Russian new thinking, and his own works were entering into the landscape. And Ольга Александровна Седокова as a poet acquires a very wide international recognition, and they keep a conversation between themselves, and they are witnessing to the new reality they are entering, and the new landscape, a new Russian landscape. And it's interesting, because and it's not that they're talking about fame as an object, but about a new landscape where they become visible as public figures. And I think there is a wonderful book of verse, something about angels, by Vyacheslav Popov, where angel is a figure of the other. A bum can be an angel, a child can be an angel, a person from Middle Asia can be a poet, somebody you meet on the train can be an angel. And through that door, the door that gives us to see our everyday life through itself is interesting. I don't want to miss much, something important, just a second. And the last book, it rose out of controversy. And some people are saying, yes, some people are saying perhaps some would reject to be part of this long list if this author is included. It's a controversial nomination of Konstantin Krylov under pseudonym Mikhail Kharitonov, was his right-wing thinker.
Это была выдвинута первая из двух книг.
His first volume out of the two. It's a book about Russian Pinocchio called Буратино, Since Our Childhood.
Такой французский.
It's called the Adventures of Буратино, La Comédie Inhumaine, as it is edited by French. The author died after writing of this two volume of this Adventures of Буратино. This is a character from our childhood, Буратино, and it's interesting that it's understandable for those who are in command of Russian language that. It's actually reddish brownish ooze, and it's taken Буратино, Буратино. It is taken from the song from the movie that is made based on the Alexei Tolstoy's 1920s novel Буратино, Russian Pinocchio. And it's but basically they rhyme Буратино and Буратино, Буратино and the reddish brownish ooze, because it's a turtle that is singing this song. And so finally he actually makes etymology of the word. The author makes etymology of Буратино from that. It's actually what he takes is our childhood Soviet wonderful novel. It's through the traumatic experiences of the 90s that creates a monstrous fairy tale out of it. Because we were identifying ourselves as children with this Буратино, and through the shifts and switches of this identification system, what he tries to show that because of our historical experience, we are not people, we are mutants. People cannot survive in such environment. We are only people who are mutants are surviving. So he's following the narration of Alexei Tolstoy. Буратино is looking for his golden key, but every point of this fairy tale is not what you think. There will be a golden key, which is a computer, a turtle that is some American spy, etc., etc. So it's something which is interesting. Of course, there is a kind of revanche philosophy behind it. It's an old type of movement that comes from the 30s, some nationalistic crying for a better archaic world and horror before the new times of mutants that are arriving. It's interesting how they, these intuitions of the 30s, nationalistic intuitions, archaistic intuitions, they are being rejuvenated now. But it's interesting that when we are not loving something, when we're creating anti-utopias, signs of furious satirical works, once we are furious, really furious about something, we come up with an interesting work, something that you hate, gives birth to some maximum artistic potency. And this is one of the cases. And this is, of course, a sad shadow that is thrown on the cast on the life of the author, that he wasted his last years on talking about something he really hated. And he managed to create something very successful. And its uniqueness, in its singularity, it will maybe stay in Russian literature, because this is amazing work of mythologies that are giving birth to us with the Russian language. Because we actually think of Russian language as a mainstream, literary mainstream, that we learn in school. But there are also the cinematic language, animation languages, songs, that can be reintroduced within the body of the normative language. And there is this wonderful childish monster that is created, like in the children's horror movies, an alternative reality, and it turns out to be an interesting reality and quite an original work. I tried to show it through the name of Buratino, how it is transposed and it's flipped flopped over itself. But in his language, he actually flipped flopped the whole of the Russian language. That is the Soviet reality of his childhood that is introduced and is pushed to work within the body of the Russian language. And it's interesting that this nomination cast its own light over the season today, this of the year. But the prize, our literary prize, is attentive, inattentive, and a long-playing, long-term attempt. There is a kind of maternal virtue about it. We have time to wait. We don't exclude anybody. We are interested in talent and inner drive. Perhaps it can be just like a childish offense. I can feel a lot of childish resentment in Kharitonov, for example. But it's a good, it's interesting and successful work of art. And the last book I would like to speak about, the work of Mikhail Epstein, Postmodernism in Russia, in a significant book that includes the articles of Mikhail Epstein that he wrote back in the 90s when he was working directly with postmodernism, and his analysis of the whole present day and analysis of the whole movement and its relation of Russian postmodernism to the Western ones. It's postmodernism in retard, being retarded, and both it's in avant-garde in comparison to the Western postmodernism, because Western postmodernism finds itself in a situation that we know well, and we actually had it already, but also the Western postmodernism seems to be very important, and the loyalty to the Western, to the postmodernism in Russia is important, because otherwise we will fall back into the archaic stage ourselves, which we don't need. So it's a kind of it's about our being included into the world process, cultural process that is now on the verge of its leaving the frame of postmodernism. And now we pass on to the short list. First, it's the draft of Newton, which we discussed with Kirill Martynov. The second our nominee is the book of Andrei Zorin, The Life of Leo Tolstoy, which was discussed together with Yuri Saprykin, literary critic. The third book, it's the book, it's a politological poem by Gleb Pavlovsky, Ironic Empire, Risks, Chances, and Dogma of the System RF, of RF System, because he thinks that Russian Federation is not a state but a system. And the last, the fourth book is by cultural anthropologist Mikhail Yampolsky, Representation, which was a course of lectures which was written into a book, remaining quite loyal to this structure of lectures. And the last book of interviews, it's a collection of interviews named by one of the interviews, The Matter of the Human Humanness. We can ask a question. My first association, it's the matter of humanness, is the word. It's what she was talking about in our conversation together with Ghassan Husseinov, because the system of our conversations of this year, it's actually two interviewers from the jury, and the heads of the project are Kirill Martynov, my partner in conversations, and me, because we are actually conducting this kind of conversational parts of the prime. And because of COVID and the Zoom, we came up with a new genre where it's not an author's conversation with the audience as it used to be, but we actually it's an interview from two positions, the interview of the author from two different positions on the system of his ideas packed into his book, his or her books. And Olga Alexander Sedakova was saying that the matter of the humanness is something associated with Andrei Platonov, but in fact it was taken from the encyclical of John Paul II, to his letter to the artists, world artists. He was saying that the work of an artist that is connected to religion, because the main matter of the artist is not his medium or her medium, but the first matter is the human nature as such. And then you work through this. You cut, you write, you paint, you play, but you have to find that human element within yourself. It's this first material that on which you are putting, you are imprinting everything. And the human being is working with the human matter that is installed within it. It's, that's why it's kind of creationist position. This is a humanitarian project. In this sense, all our programs are humanitarian. In this, natural sciences are the same, but and the artist, in religious sense, is closer than the scholar that has a lot of mediums in between himself and that object. The artist works directly. And in this time, if to characterize these books in overall, to give them overall characteristics, I think it's a very strong anthropological effort. To me, vice versa, it seems that the books of these shortlists are closer to geological topographic efforts. Let's talk about them. Let's start from each of them, and probably we'll end up with the overall view of them. Because one of the tasks of the prize is to give an overall theme. What is our impression? What these all books are about? What they're pointing to? Is there a joint vector? Let's start with Alexander Lichevsky, who was the first one interviewed. It's the travelogue, a palimpsest novel, looking for the father, looking for meaning, looking for the temple. And of course, there is also mother-in-law he was looking for, who disappeared somewhere in the Utah desert, yes, when she left Soviet Union. In general, it's the look, search for one's parents that in the beginning of the 90s who left for different reasons, and they all disappeared. The woman disappears in America, the man disappears in Israel. He's looking for them, and through this search, he is acquiring the spaces, the new spaces, and the spaces give him a view over the tourist flows that are inhabiting them, those landscapes. There are touristic flows that are looking for ghosts in California, and it's a big business. And on the other hand, there are touristic flows that are appropriating Israel, the holy places of Israel. And his father, whom he's looking for, is turning from a fanatical connoisseur of Moscow, he turns into a person, a guide for a smaller kind of touristic groups around these sacred places. But within the center of that experience, there is his meditation of what he understands about this black matter, this dark matter, this antimateria, which for him is associated or identified with consciousness as such. And for him, it is a study of the borderlines of mind, of consciousness. And finally, it is a work with the anthropological parameter of the word, whatever you're saying about the geological time. What is this draft of Newton? Newton, having made all his physical discovery, material discoveries, he starts drawing the Judean temple that disappeared after the Roman invasion. And it's kind of transition to a new stage. The temple that was once dissolved, and Newton is building up it, drawing it on the basis of the Bible. It's like a magnifying glass for the matter, and matter becomes a kind of screen. Caves around that place become the screen that collects the remains of the photographs, so to speak, the temple, and become the irradiate back the meaning, and the borderline between geological and human, material and inhuman, it dissolves and becomes a meaning flow, the creation. We can speak of matter and antimatter, but in fact antimatter created matter, and everything, and something like that, something similar, is lies within the center of our consciousness. And because he's looking for the father, which is a central figure for the formation of the meaning in our minds, it becomes a landscape as well. And this very geology and the spirits that inhabit it, these are the spirits that inhabit the past or the landscape we live in. And it's interesting when you asked about memory, and he started really confronting, he didn't want to talk about it because he doesn't want to go into memory. And me as well, I can see that we are now actually going away from the neurotic study of memory to the new generating point of the beginning of the consciousness, where we can start projecting the future. We can enter this antimatter, as Ilichevsky probably would say, into the black points in our mind. And how should we act now? The book of Ilichevsky is saying the fathers and mothers, they are within the landscape already. We cannot enter that experience endlessly. And he recreates what his father couldn't create on the basis of the archive of his father. He recreates the temple. It's not for tourists, but for the new beginning, the new conversation on how we will exist in this post-apocalyptic space. I would want to speak about geography more. I read, also read some smaller pieces by Ilichevsky. What is important for him, what he's looking for in his journeys? He looks for in different journeys of his,
he's looking
for whatever he's looking for, he's looking at for the point wherever we can establish a connection with the metaphysical, and he thinks that those deserted spaces, and he goes to the deserted spaces of Persia, closer to the Astrakhan city, where the most extreme events happen to him, where he's attacked by the beasts. And this journey is connected to the extreme existence of his. I think this intention is important. Where is that place where metaphysics exists? But yes, of course, when this metaphysical point is acquired, we are being ready to move on, because we were moving within the paradigm of the end of the author, the end of the of literature, the end of art, the end of everything, the end of history. Yes, but now the end has ended, and now we find ourselves within the space where historicism itself is ending, and the authors of the world of this season are telling us historicism is ending. We cannot actually calculate at the points of the present from the past. What is post-apocalyptical? And it's not for nothing that Ilichevsky is traveling around deserts, that the space where everything, all that is has ended. We have this matter of humanness as such. And what is this temple, the draft of the temple? It's the scheme of Adam's body, in fact, if we speak about religion, religious connotations. We find ourselves within the draft. It's a scheme. It has no history, and we find ourselves in this new type of there is a new study of human nowadays and biology, etc. And now, for example, COVID. It's the situation that through cutting through history joined us all together. We have been living for a long time within the histories of our nations and tragedies and traumas that are passing to present and come back to the past. And now we are united with the same scheme, with same network of virus, so to speak. And whatever Andrei Zorin was telling us, the next author, he was saying, I'm a person of ironic age, the age which is ending, but I can see something that goes on, goes next. Tolstoy is more adequate to it. There is no irony about him, but there is no irony about it. There is joy about him. Tolstoy is very serious. Tolstoy is very knowledgeable about this material. He plays Tolstoy as if he were playing drums. Because when Tolstoy, when they were excommunicating him, what he was saying about, if I could believe in something else, I would just drop my previous beliefs easily, but I can't. So he's a very serious, and whatever Andrei Zorin is talking about, Tolstoy is very critical of Enlightenment project, but basically he believes in the basic idea of Enlightenment, that there is reason in you, there is a scheme in you. Nothing important what matters. Tolstoy worked with history a lot, with the preceding situation that leads to the present, but finally, in the end of life, he cuts it all away. Zorin is talking well about the working points or energetic points of Tolstoy that work today. He says that Tolstoy had amnesia by the end of his life, but his spiritual path was never influenced. In our contemporary self-descriptions, we actually say that the loss of memory is the loss of personality. But Tolstoy was saying no. At this point, he was stronger than this loss. He says, I don't need this memory. These are extra files. Why should I keep that all? God bless me for not remembering anything. But I can still be myself. I can be that scheme of the human. I can be when God made Adam's design, there was no history. And I think that we are making this effort that with the new research in science and biology, we are entering the new idea of the human being, because we have to integrate more knowledge within ourselves. There is more data, and something that is not cannot be part of historicistic approach. And that's why when we talked with history, we both came to the two ideas, that Tolstoy is a representative of the world that is ending, and Zorin is very particular about it. He says that a big epoch is easier presented in something unique, in a unique phenomenon, a unique manifestation. The more unique is the human you are talking about, the more exact you become about more general idea of epoch, because you can't describe general ideas with general ideas. The more you dig into detail about a unique person like Tolstoy, the more you understand about an epoch which in terms of Tolstoy, that started in the 18th century and is ending up now. But Zorin is being very cunny. He's saying we are all past, but Tolstoy remains. He can overcome that end. And also, it's interesting that Ilyichevsky is talking back, harking back to the 18th century, to Newton's figure. The same happens with Zorin. He goes back to Jean-Jacques Rousseau, and he sort of, Tolstoy is standing by the side of Rousseau. He just dislikes whatever happened next after Rousseau. We are coming back to the study of the human being through reason, the engineering thought about human being, when this dark element of history in the 18th century, it was seen as Middle Ages, with all these chronicles, complicated genealogies. This was cast away. There is just a human being. This is human being. This is a man. This is a woman. I would want to end. And what about Gleb Pavlovsky, his book, which is written as a response to the lack of the historical studies of the last 30 years after the break of the Soviet Union. Gleb Pavlovsky's effort is also about a draft, because he's a scheme. He's saying that the Russian Federation system is not Soviet Union, and it's because what was the weakness of the of the Sovietologists and post-Sovietological study, because he was saying the Western researchers wanted to see as something like the last accords of the Soviet mentality, which is not interesting, which is not a threat anywhere, and they missed the arrival of a new model that sprang from something else. They thought that everything is weak. We have to study it as we study the aboriginal cultures, as Soviet and post-Soviet man, not noticing, not seeing what is going on. How he described this system as reprogramming. In this his conversation with Kirill Martynov and Ivan Davidov, he was speaking about computer. He was speaking about some program that rewrites itself. He calls it an evil computer that is cannot sync. It's unsyncable. And because he was for a long time part of that computer, of the programmers of this computer. And to work with it, he wanted, what's this force of this book? He works as a poet because correlating with his own experience, he finds formulations, and this is very important for him, that are not being borrowed from the Western manuals, although he is actually showing to a wide extent how the Soviet and American politological traditions are important for him, but we have to need for new formulations, and they're quite successful. That's what amazes everyone, how he exact he is, how the focus he created, how he kind of extrapolated this ghost out of the computer, ghost out of the machine, this phenomenon.
It's,
once you describe it well, then you understand what is going on. Once you try to suppress him through the narrative of the Western school, what happens is, yes, as a result, yes, you can talk. It's so weak. You don't know how it exists. You don't know how it can survive. But it's a suppressive discourse, and it doesn't describe anything. But he describes not a human being, but he actually is describing a leviathan, a super being that is created from 0.0,
and it is.
And Pavlovsky, in fact, he is reminiscent of Hoffman's character, the Sandman, famous fairy tale. He was extracting human eyes and creates dolls. It's an old romantic tale. First of all, it's about how it's hard to discern between natural and artificial. Pavlovsky, of course, springs from this romantic thinking, because it's irony. Yes, of course, irony is a romantic tool. Because this natural, this sandman creates this doll, and the same way he speaks about the Russian Federation, it was created as an attempt of imitation, an art piece. And Goffman already showed that imitation of something is not the same as the natural origin. It has its negative energy. It's not history. It has its program. The doll that is similar to a living human being will be an evil.
It will be.
It's not will be a doll that is just like similar to a girl, living girl. The same problematics was in Russian, in the Soviet drama playwright, the playwright Isaac Schwartz. It's about shadow, the shadow that replaces a living human being. It becomes evil. He shows that how we reduplicated, the imitated the Western forms, and we created that artificial monster. And then he comes back to Peter the Great, who was doing actually the same thing, and he wants to come back to the empire project of Russia, that it's a kind of, it was the same, and it's interesting, the history is now seen as a programming and reprogramming oneself. It has no history, it's just rejuvenates itself. And I would want, and it starts from Peter the Great, this evil computer. And I was actually studying Soviet studies in America, and how they are speaking about themselves and their histories, and how they're critical about that. And it's quite interesting, this self-criticism, what they missed, what they were doing, how should they. There are other people who are saying, what about Russia? Let's look into China. There is no Russian threat in comparison to the Chinese threat. But the other thing is that the Sovietological studies began as the study of the enemy, whether it was right, and how, and as far as how what America saw about perestroika, that they had to introduce the market and the election system, and they thought it was just a basis, and they missed something, that the state should create these institutions, and understanding, and now they understand that that starting with some mechanisms and missing the other ones. Yeah, they miss that there is such story, that there is this such a culture, and the culture is institutions. They miss that. And reading Gleb Pavlovsky, I was asking myself, what genre is it? It's something like an artistic work of art, but there is elements of politology and public journalism. There is negative dialectics. There is a negative Russian. But that Russian. This he always proceeds with no. Russian Federation is no state but a system, starting with the population. And he invents the coinages this term populationers, i.e., members of the population, and that the main quality of them is being very swift. And he creates quite swift images. They are these images. There is an intention there that after you read this kind of negative description, finally you come up with some positive dialectics. Nevertheless, perhaps it's one of the tasks of this book, but I have not read. I have read only separate articles of such politologists as Krastev, for example. Krastev, and I don't know to what extent this format of this political studies, whether it's Gleb Pavlovsky studies original or not, but of course there is an originality. There is a book by Mikhail Impolsky, Representation. It's a very interesting approach to the theme of image. It's again stepping from the limitation outside the limitation and frame of the art history, because he starts from the basic forms of life, from DNA, and he starts with the pre-Socratic thought. He actually it's within this contemporary tradition, when we say we're starting something, we actually are going beyond Plato. Deleuze were making this step. Many other authors, when reinventing this new type of thinking, they were stepping beyond Plato. And the macro task, bigger task of Yampolsky, his bigger idea, is to show that we actually are used to think through about everything through words, and through the formation of the book world and the technological world that is bases itself on the bookish world. But in fact, everything we can talk about in history and with the formation of the world is the representation, pictures, and how light as the beginning, the first thing we see is what we see is light. Yeah, you see. We can see the light. But it can be blinding, nevertheless. Even if it's blinding, you can see the shining, because when you are blind, really, you can't see the shining. And how he shows there is a new type of science. We are living in the time of new types of science emerging, biosemiotics. The semiotics, the science about science, is now joining itself with biology, with the data of biology. He's speaking about how something that existed in the darkness within the underwater volcanoes, and he shows how all the forms were transparent and symmetrical. The moment light comes through the water, the forms of life develop, they stop being transparent, and immediately they start developing inner organs that are not symmetrical, and they start developing the outer appearance that begins to differentiate one species from the other, and all those surfaces that mesmerize our glance, all those butterflies, all these reptilias and mammals, they are all amazing pictures. But he starts with that thought. He starts not from Plato, but with pre-Socratic thinking. He's speaking about Democritus and teaching about atoms, because atoms are pictures. They get into our eye as pictures, and in his idea, in the beginning was the picture, and he's talking about the history of life of pictures, from DNA, from this is all pictures. That inscription, that those hieroglyphs that create us. And I was thinking, when human being would arrive, when, and this completely the point of Georges Bataille, it's the moment of shame. Shame creates a human being after the animal. We start covering our surfaces, we start painting ourselves, and suddenly when we understand that we can create the surfaces ourselves, we're starting from weaving. The more we weave, the more lines we unite within the weaving. First, we have a woven wool, and that creates through the through many threads, it creates a flat surface, and we start making weaving images into it. And then we get a stone wool. And Piatigorsky, just as Nietzsche said that I relieved the history of Europe within me, just Piatigorsky is relieving the history of pictures. And from starting from the simplest form of life, he comes to the works of European art. And he's saying that a human being is characterized in contradiction with other animals. He's able to block his action towards the picture, and he's able to distance himself from the picture. And he tells us about how a human being arrives. It has an outer appearance, begins to differentiate himself from other human species and the world. And Piatigorsky shows that every point in the history of the work of art, it's a scheme of our communication to the world, how I see the world. And the world changes, I change, and that's why we have to develop the pictures. And the picture is a scheme of reappropriation of the world, and it's also a signal which I'm sending to the other. We are in a constant flow of signals that we are sending to other people. And I asked him in our conversation, and how do you think, what characterizes the human being? He says, an animal cannot lie. An animal sees the pictures, it's either it's eatable or edible or inedible. It's threatening or not threatening. Human being is the first animal that is doubts the picture in his endless flow of pictures, because he completely changes whether it's threatening or not threatening, whether it's edible and it's edible. An animal will eat only what it sees, and human being has to develop the whole cuisine, because it's a critical capacity. But once we start, we take the scheme of Piatigorsky, we come back to the 18th century scheme of Descartes, because the only thing I doubt is that I don't doubt. If I'm doubting, I'm thinking. If I'm thinking, I exist. So we come back to the point of the 18th century, if we drag it to the end of it. Taking away the historicity of the 19th century, we come back to the 18th century. And what I would, before we pass on to the fifth participant of the conversation, or I will end with Piatigorsky's thought. And it's important, for Piatigorsky, Mandelstam is very important. He's an amazing writer. To describe everything he wants to describe and integrate everything he wants to integrate, he creates a very vivid language. And I recognize Mandelstam's reading him, and I actually missed that. He had a research in Mandelstam. And what Mandelstam is talking about, what he's saying, he says that we are creating the colossal works of historicism, and we need a kind of counter movement. It's a blessed encyclopedic overview of the 18th century. And he shows the avant-garde effort that tries to cast away the historicism, historical meanings of word, everything we accumulated, the baggage, and come back to the new blessedness. It's the pilot, the scheme, the the flying. And this this was a pure move which was suppressed by Stalinism with this historical form, with his ideas of historical formation, with empire style, the return of the 19th century. It actually was very suppressive to this avant-garde intention. But finally, it's growing back, and it inscribes Russia back into the world's history, just as. Just as Slepian will give his animal to Deleuze and Guattari because they borrowed that from his play How I Became a Dog. They read this play and developed the idea of the animal. Everybody's talking about the new approach to human being. And for Mandelstam, it was coming through evolutionary creationist approach, through the minerals, through fishes, through animals, to join that geological time to ourselves, not just historical and power concept. I want to say that I was lucky to attend those lectures of Piatigorsky, especially in the beginning, how he was speaking about how our eye is constructed, how we see. But the major joy I received from through the last chapters of the book and the lectures where you didn't attend. And there is a whole range of ideas that is adequate to the contemporary moments. And he speaks about museums, he finds places and non-places, and non-places are not only airports where all sorts of transitions are taking place and all the sorts of meanings, but it's also museums. They have to be historical, but in fact they are quite different. They are the spaces of affects, and the curators are not the people who are creating their exhibitions with the historical theme in mind, but in fact what they are doing is the montage of affects and all sorts of affects we are seeing not only on television, which we're accustomed to as TV viewers, but this book is important not only for those people who want to understand what image is, what picture is, what representation is, how it gets deciphered or used, but also how whoever finds himself within the contemporary museum industry and exhibitionary industry, which in contemporary Russia becomes quite intense, and that coming came to its peak, but which was now cut by COVID pandemia, which cut its ever-growing intensivity. And the next book we're going on is an amazing book by Olga Sedakova, her interview starting with 1993 with all sorts of partners in conversation, ending with, I think, 2016, and there is an article of hers about Andrei Zvyagintsev's Leviathan. Olga Sedakova is now one of the best international poets today, recognized worldwide. She travels a lot. It gets all sorts of poetic prizes and being published in all sorts of languages. And also this person finds itself in the counterbalance to the main trends of time. As her teacher Sergei Averintsev was saying, if everybody is on the one side of the boat, you have to go to the other side for the boat not to sink. And the spirit of time, which was telling a lot about the discourse of trauma, historical memory, and in her thought comes to the idea of human being as it was designed, and she thinks that anthropologically about that, and she finds her own merit as a researcher, that she was the first one to put together two words, poetry and anthropology, in her article, that poetry is not just an object of philology and literary critical, although she's a Slavic studies researcher and she's a great translator of poetry from French and English and German, but she is Italian, but she is talking about a human being as an anthropologist. Category and poetry as an anthropological parameter is if Piatigorsky speaks about art as anthropological category. She speaks of art as anthropological category as well. Poetry is anthropological category, and poetry is a poetic characteristic is a characteristic of human being as such. It's not that. That's why we should not be looking into poets, as romantic would put it. She says that's why we have to look into human being. And after all sorts of social experiments of the 20th century, she's speaking about the innate scheme of being within human being that pushes you to a certain direction. And of course, when it's being broken or violated, it happens. And she says, it's not that I don't want to talk about trauma, but I want to talk something about before trauma. And she's saying that in all the experiences of the concentration camps, Soviet and German, she was interested not in the common sociological data as to how people generally behave, but the experience of the people who supporting themselves through their own nature, not on the values of some culture. There are certain values, for example, if I don't wash my face, then I'm not a human being. That's why I can behave as an animal, as a beast. No, your humanity stays within you. It's this human matter is within you, this scheme, and supported by that scheme which you find in yourself, they continued behaving as human beings. They saved, they treated medically, they preserved the decency of other people, and that is, from a point of view, is poetry as such. And this is a task of poetry. The task of poetry is the praise of poetry, the praise of being created, the state of being created. It's the witness, it's the evidence, the witness testimony of that human being is good as a creation. And in this is a point of meeting points of anthropology, religion, and poetry. And all the interviews that are aimed at different points in actual life, they are demonstrating this as an overall theme. She lives through, and she creates a new conceptual apparatus. It's probably too mechanical a word, apparatus. A new way of thinking and description. And if we say that Andrei Zorin is writing about a major artist, Mikhail Piatigorsky is speaking about art as a scheme, Olga Sidakova is demonstrating in her own speech how it all functions and works, how from that focus you are thinking all sorts of great moments like Rembrandt, greater issues of culture or philosophy, or world events, or various minor actual newspaper events. And it's interesting how she thinks about Andrei Zvyagintsev's actual work, contemporary work, about Leviathan. And for her, it's a contemporary masterpiece. And why she's talking about it.
And
I think it's a singing anthropology, a living anthropology, which talks by itself, not through apparatus and through the descriptions of anti-life, which we create in the place of the human being.
Вот, мне кажется, это очень интересно.
I think it's very important. It's interesting.
Вот если говорить обо всех
And if we are talking to talk about the whole overall space, it's a new space of utopia. What is utopia? It's utopos, it's non-place. We are not territorial animals. We actually inhibit a new utopia when the new utopian spaces are opening to us. It's this sort of theoretical space. We are living our new historical formation, but before that we have to have that page open before us so we can make our new scheme on that surface. And I think that these books are utopian in their character. It's got a bit of an alternative in their reality. But it's interesting, and I think it's a new turn.